Then we'll see what is the impact of tax on price and quantity. In this case, we'll take the case of the unit tax, which is generally the tax per unit of output sold, and we'll see how it generally affects the price and quantity. And whenever there is a imposition of tax, who generally takes the tax burden, whether it's the buyers, whether it's the seller, that we'll analyze or that we'll see through the graphical representation. So, this is the, in this case specifically we are talking about the unit tax, which is that is tax per unit of output sold. So, now let us see different cases and different scenario how the tax burden gets shared between the supplier and the buyer. D0 is the demand curve, S0 is the supply curve. There is imposition of tax, and the imposition of tax will represent through the decrease in the supply, and that leads to decrease in the supply from S0 to S1. Now, this is the equilibrium quantity, this is the equilibrium price. Now, there is imposition of tax, and that leads to a change in the supply from S0 to S1, and here we are representing the amount of tax through the change in the supply. So, this is the total amount of tax being imposed. When the supply moved from S0 to S1, the equilibrium point changed from E1 to E2. In this case also the price and quantity changes, quantity is Q1 and price is P1. What is the total amount of tax? This is the total amount of tax. So, in this case, now who share the taxes over here? Initially, demand curve is D0, supply curve is S0, quantity, equilibrium quantity is Q0, equilibrium price is P0. Imposition of tax that leads to shift the supply curve from S0 to S1, and the difference between two supply curve gives us the tax, which is equal to P0T. Now, this P0T, who is paying how much of this P0T? Due to change in the supply, now the producer has increased the price from P0 to P1. So, this P1 and P0 is paid by the consumer in term of increase in the price, and the rest of the amount of tax, that is P1 by T, that has to be paid by the supplier, because this part of tax is not being covered by increase in the price. So, supplier or seller. So, imposition of tax is there, that leads to shift in the S, that is decreasing the quantity, increasing the price, but the increase in the price is not equal to the amount of tax being imposed. So, there is some more amount left from the tax amount, that is P1 and T. So, this tax is the tax burden is shared by both the consumer and the producer. P0 P1 is paid by the consumer in term of increase in the price, and P1T is paid by the seller or paid by the supplier, because partly it has to be shared for both the producer and the consumer. So, in case of unit tax imposed, if the both the demand and supply curve they are maintaining their original slope, in this case, or the original relationship, in this case the partly it has been paid by the consumer in term of increase in the price, and partly it has been paid by the producer. Now, we will introduce the concept of elasticity of demand and elasticity of supply to this supply and demand curve, and then we will see how the tax gets shared between the consumer and the supplier. What happens when there is a perfectly inelastic demand curve? What happens when there is a perfectly inelastic supply curve? What happens when there is a perfectly elastic and perfectly elastic demand curve and perfectly elastic supply curve? सो फर्स्ट विल टेक ए केस ऑफ ए परफेक्टली इलास्टिक डिमांड कर्व. नाउ व्हाट इज द शेप ऑफ ए परफेक्टली इलास्टिक डिमांड कर्व? इट इज पैरेलल टू द हॉरिजॉन्टल एक्सिस. ओके, सो दिस इज द डिमांड कर्व. नाउ दिस इज द सप्लाई कर्व, दिस इज द क्वांटिटी. ओके, नाउ देयर इज ए इम्पोजिशन ऑफ टैक्स दैट लीड्स टू शिफ्ट इन द सप्लाई कर्व फ्रॉम एस जीरो टू S1. Now what is the amount of tax? The amount of tax is this much. Okay. Now who is paying the tax over here? It's not that because price remain constant or very small change in the price, the quantity demanded changes. So there is, if you look at, there is no change in the quantity demanded, and if there is no change in the quantity demanded, the tax amount cannot be, or maybe if there is a possibility to increase the price, that is not possible here, and that is the reason if you look at even if the quantity demanded is changing, what is the change in the price? Maybe the change in the price is this much. So now who is paying the tax over here? Whatever may be the price, because any small change in the price, that leads to change in the greater change in the quantity demanded, and that is the reason the, and in this case the entire tax is paid by the supplier. So in case of perfectly elastic demand curve, the entire tax is paid by supplier, because for any small change in the price, the quantity demanded generally changes in a very quantity demanded changes drastically, because this is the case of a perfectly elastic demand curve. The consumer is more sensitive in this case. That is the reason the entire tax burden is paid by supplier, because they are not able to transfer the tax burden in term of increase in the price. Because if they will increase the price, that will lead to shift in the quantity demanded, and in term of that also they are going to lose profit if there is no sale of the product or if the quantity demanded decreases. Then we will see the second case, that is the perfectly inelastic demand curve. So in case of perfectly inelastic demand curve takes a shape which is parallel to price axis. Okay. So this is your demand curve. Now this is Q0. This is S0, this is P0, P0 is equilibrium price, Q0 is equilibrium quantity. Now imposition of tax S1, this is the total amount of tax, this is the new price P1. Okay. Now what is the situation over here? Demand curve is perfectly inelastic, whatever may be the change in the price, it is not going to change the quantity demanded. That gives us the flexibility for the producer to shift the entire tax burden to the consumer. So this is the total amount of tax, and if you look at, the increase in the price is just equal to the increase in the tax, that is P1, P0 is equal to the total tax. So in this case the producer has shifted the entire tax burden to the consumer in term of increase in the price, and we can interpret here is that in case of inelastic demand, perfectly inelastic demand, the consumer pays the entire tax burden because there is no change in the quantity demanded, even if there is a change in the price, and that gives the liberty to producer to shift the entire tax burden to the consumer. So in case of perfectly elastic supply, the entire tax burden paid by the perfectly elastic demand, the entire tax burden is paid by the supplier. In case of inelastic demand, the perfectly inelastic demand, the entire tax burden is paid by the consumer. Now we will see what happens in case of perfectly elastic supply and perfectly inelastic supply. क्यू जीरो पी जीरो पी परफेक्टली इलास्टिक सप्लाई इम्पोजिशन ऑफ टैक्स मूव्स एस जीरो टू एस वन एंड देर इज ए सेम इम्पोजिशन ऑफ इंक्रीज इन द प्राइस दैट इज पी जीरो बाई पी वन. सो इन दिस केस द अमाउंट ऑफ टैक्स इज गेटिंग ट्रांसफर्ड टू द कंज्यूमर इन टर्म ऑफ इंक्रीज इन प्राइस बिकॉज पी वन पी जीरो इज जस्ट इक्वल द टैक्स एंड द एंटायर टैक्स बर्डन इज पेड बाय द बायर्स बिकॉज द टैक्स टोटल टैक्स अमाउंट इज शिफ्टेड टू कंज्यूमर इन टर्म ऑफ इंक्रीज इन प्राइस. सो परफेक्टली इलास्टिक सप्लाई कर द टैक्स इज पेड बाय द बायर्स. देन विल सी द केस ऑफ द परफेक्टली इनइलास्टिक सप्लाई कर. सो इन केस ऑफ परफेक्टली इनइलास्टिक सप्लाई कर सप्लाई कर्व टेक्स ए वैल्यू दैट इज पैरेलल टू द प्राइस एक्सिस. इट मीन्स व्हाट एवर मे बी द चेंज इन द सप्लाई इट इज नॉट गोइंग टू व्हाट एवर मे बी द चेंज इन द प्राइस इट इज नॉट गोइंग टू चेंज द क्वांटिटी सप्लाई. सो इन दिस केस नो इफेक्ट ऑन परफेक्टली इनइलास्टिक सप्लाई देर इज नो इफेक्ट ऑन प्राइस एंड क्वांटिटी बिकॉज इम्पोजिशन ऑफ टैक्स विल नॉट लीड टू एनी चेंज इन द सप्लाई कर्व रादर. बट वेन देर इज ए इम्पोजिशन ऑफ टैक्स जनरली दैट रिड्यूसेस द प्रॉफिट ऑफ द सेलर. सो इन केस ऑफ इनइलास्टिक सप्लाई कर्व देर इज नो इफेक्ट ऑन प्राइस एंड क्वांटिटी डिमांडेड दैट इज द रीजन द कंज्यूमर इज नॉट गेटिंग अफेक्टेड. बट देर इज सम इन्फ्लुएंस ऑन द सेलर दैट इज इन टर्म ऑफ चेंज इन द प्राइस or in term of maybe change reduce quantity and that leads to reduce profit for the seller. So when there is a imposition of tax that leads to the fact that the tax burden get equally share between the buyers and seller. But when we introduce the concept of elasticity, if the buyer is more sensitive then it is the tax burden is more on seller. If the buyer is less sensitive, tax burden is more on buyer. Similarly, if the supplier is more sensitive, tax burden is more on consumer. If the supplier is less sensitive, generally that reduces the profit of the seller. Now we'll see the specific two cases like sell tax and excise tax, how that leads to change in the price or quantity demanded or how it affects generally the sellers and consumer. Okay, so if you summarize the previous analysis of imposition of unit tax, if the demand curve is perfectly inelastic, price increases by the full amount of the tax and supply remain unchanged, the entire tax is borne by the consumer. If the supply curve is perfectly inelastic, there will be no increase in the price or decrease in the supply. The whole of the tax is borne by the supplier. If the demand curve is perfectly elastic, the price does not rise at all and the whole tax is borne by the seller. If the supply curve is perfectly elastic, the price rise by the full amount of tax and the entire tax borne by the consumer. But given the supply schedule, the greater the elasticity of demand for the good, less will be the tax burden on the consumer. Given the demand schedule, the greater is the elasticity of supply, the greater will be the tax burden borne by the buyer. Then we'll introduce two new taxes, sell tax and excise tax, in order to understand what is their impact on price and quantity. So sell tax is the tax imposed on consumer, paid directly to the government, does not affect the price. consumers pay price plus sales taxes. So tax is not the part of the price. Less desirable to buy the taxed good or service at every given price. Demand shift downward and to the left because there is a decrease in the demand when there is a imposition of tax. So this is the effect of sales tax on demand. Suppose a new law require $0.25 sales tax per cup of coffee. So if you look at the demand schedule on the left hand side of the graph, when the price is changing by 0.50 to 0.75 to 1, if you look at there is a difference in the quantity before tax and after tax, that leads to shift in the demand curve from D to D dash. So it means the effect of sales tax reduces the demand. Then the government imposes tax on producer. In case of excise tax, the government imposes tax on producer. Producer pay the tax directly to the government. Price does not change, but the cost changes because they are paying a tax to him. Less desirable to produce taxed good or service at every given price. Supply shift to the left and upward. So if you look at, due to imposition of excise tax, that leads to decrease in the supply and that leads to shift in the supply curve from S to S dash. So if you look at, in this case, suppose there is excise tax of 0.25 per cup of coffee, that leads to change in the quantity supply, that is imposition of tax before and after, and that leads to decrease in the quantity supply, and graphically the change in the quantity supply is represented from the movement from S to S dash. So irrespective of whether it's sales tax, whether it's excise tax, it generally reduces the demand and supply. In case of sales tax, that reduces the demand. In case of excise tax, that reduces the supply. So what is the effect of sales tax? Sales tax, suppose this XC per item cause equilibrium price to fall by the same amount less than XC per item. Price to supplier not same as price to the demander, because price plus sales tax is the price to the buyers. And what is the effect of excise tax? Excise tax per item causes the equilibrium price to increase by some amount less than XC per item. Price to the supplier, that is price minus excise tax, is not same as the price to the demand. So in case of sales tax, the price to the consumer is on a higher side, and in case of excise tax, the price generally what is part of the cost also, in the due course of time generally they shift it to the consumer, but initially when they are paying excise tax, whatever the price for them, that is cost of production for tax, that is not equal to the market price what the consumer they pay for it. So generally in case of imposition of sales tax, reduces the equilibrium price, but in case of imposition of excise tax, it reduces the equilibrium price. So when you compare two cases, maybe there are two type of incidents. One is economic incident, second one is the legal incidents. The division of a tax burden according to who actually pay the tax, that is on the basis of the economic incidents, and legal incidents is the division of tax burden according to who is required under the law to pay the tax. So one is legally and another is the actually who is paying more. So the economic incidence of tax independent of its legal incidence. Now this is the graphical representation of sales tax and the excise tax, how it affects the demand. So initially if you look at the first graph, left hand top graph, the imposition of tax leads to decrease in the demand from D to D dash. That leads to increase in the price from PF to PG. So the price to supplier is PF, whereas the price to consumer is PC, which includes the price plus the tax. And in the right hand side, if you look at the top one, then imposition of excise tax leads to shift the or decrease the supply from S to S dash, and that leads to two type of price. One is the price to supplier and second one is the price to demand. So in both the cases, if you look at, the price is changing. So in the left hand side, if you look at the maybe the graph which is just below, maybe a less cluttered version of the panel A. In this case, the new supply, the new demand and maybe the original supply gives us the change in the price. And similarly, in the right hand panel, the lower graph, if you look at it, it's again the change in the supply and change in the demand and exactly whatever the change in the price. So, excise tax influence the producers and generally sell tax influence the buying behavior of the consumer, whereas excise tax influence the selling behavior of the producer. Then we will discuss about two specific case where the price is decided by the government or where the price is decided by legally in case of the imbalances and what happens to the situation. So, consumer if you look at always like the prices to be lower than the actual equilibrium price, and when the outcomes of the unregulated market act against the interest of the public, people seek legislation that allow the government authority to control the existing price structure of the market. Sometimes it happens that they form, they collude, they make a joint collusion and they decide the price. In this case, generally the interest of public, generally the government comes into picture and they fix up a price. This type of interference on the part of government with the help of laws of supply and demand is totally different from the case of the imposition of tax. This is not the case of taxes, and government control of price inevitably prevents the market system from performing its function of rationing goods and services. So, two type of cases, one is price ceiling, and it is a type of price ceiling that government authority sometimes used for rental housing, and the specific case here is the rent control. Prevent housing market for reaching equilibrium only when the rents are set below the market equilibrium rent, and the typical example is the after the end of World War II, when there was a sharp increase in the price of the rent or the sharp increase in the housing price or the demand for the housing, many cities instituted the rent control to prevent the spectacular increase in the rent that were anticipated, because there is an increase in the demand and that also leads to the increase in the rent, and many cases they practice this rent control. Generally, how this can be applicable? In case of controlling the rent to a level which is below the equilibrium rate. So, typically rent control limit increase in the monthly rental rates or the established rule used to determine the fair monthly rent for housing of varying kind of quality. Rent generally lower than that would prevail in the equilibrium in the competitive market. Many supporters of rent control believes that this control benefit lower income people who would otherwise have to pay a higher percentage as of their income as rent. Now, how it works? Generally, if you look at, this is the supply of housing, this is the demand for housing. Price is nothing but the rent. Suppose this price in this case is 1000 rupees and the quantity is maybe suppose 8000 unit. Now, if the rent looks higher, generally the public seeks the legislation from the government to charge a lower price. So, in this case, if the government fix up a rent which is equal to rupees 500, now what would be the outcome? The demand would be more and the supply would be less. So, suppose this is 10,000 units because of decrease in the rent, that leads to increase in the demand for housing to 1000 unit, but the supply of housing reduces to 6000 unit. So, this leads to shortage. So, whenever there is a rent control and the rent is set much below the equilibrium rent, in this case the demand for housing is more than supply of housing, which leads to shortage. Then in this case, what is the way out? Because rent was on a higher side, that is the reason the public comes to the government support to fix up the rent. And if the rent is lower than the equilibrium rent, generally people they prefer a high demand for housing and the supply is there, reduces the supply. So, in this case, maybe one possible solution is to follow a non-rationing rent control. And what is the non-rationing rent control or non-rationing or the non-price maybe solution, the non-price solution is to that first come first serve basis. So at a specific price, even if it is 6,000 or even if the rent is 500, only people with up to 8,000 they will be entertained, not more beyond 10,000. So the in this case the surplus can be captured on the basis of the first come first serve. So it's only the 8,000 units of housing available at a price of 500, and they should the supplier will only there is binding on the supplier also to supply at least 8,000 unit of the housing at the rent of 500. The second case what we'll deal here is the opposite of price ceiling is price floor. So now what is price floor? Okay, so this effect of rent control is if selling on rent is below the market equilibrium rent, this inevitably result in the shortage of the rental housing what we checked in the previous graph. Rent control do not make renter house less expensive to the tenant. Lender respond to the reduction in the possible gain by decreasing the quantity and often the quality of the rental houses supplied. Results is shortage of housing. And then we'll take the second case, that is price floor. Opposite to the price ceiling, this is the minimum price that has to be given or that has to be given by the supplier. Now, what is the typical example here? The typical example is the minimum wage. The producer has to pay wage which is at least minimum that is set by the law. So, to commonly use price floor are minimum wages and the agricultural price support. Minimum wages prohibit employees from paying less than the stipulated wage, and agricultural price support generally guarantee farmers a minimum price of their crops. When price floor are set above the market equilibrium price, and generally this results in the surplus on the market. So let's see a graphical example of this minimum wage. So we have a demand curve, we have a supply curve. This is the equilibrium quantity, this is the equilibrium price. Now what is the equilibrium price here? This is nothing but the wage. So suppose this is 50 rupees is the wage and this is the 30 laborers, this is the labor day. Now if the minimum wage is set at 40, okay, so just if the minimum wage is set at 60, which is as a higher than the equilibrium, in this case what would be the outcome? The demand would be more. Suppose 60 laborer will ready to work when the wage is 60, but the supplier is ready to only give the employment to 20 laborer when the minimum wage is fixed by legally and that is 60. So in this case what is the outcome? The outcome is surplus. So in case of minimum wage, if the minimum wage is set above the equilibrium wage, that is equilibrium wage is 50 and the minimum wage is 60, it means it's binding on the supplier to pay the wages equal to 60. In this case generally the demand for the labor or the demand for the employment will be more, that is 60 unit, but whatever the supply of labor, the producer is only ready to give employment to 20 laborer if the wage is set at 60. This lead to surplus in the market, and again it's a non-price control will come, the first come first serve basis. This 20 laborer who are ready to work, they will come first, 20 units will be entertained. So in this case if you look at the real problem, again leads to something else. When the price is goes on a higher side or the wage is going on a higher side, that leads to less employment. So two cases, one is price ceiling, which is the price fixed by the government, and second one is the price floor. This is also price fixed by the government, and this is the minimum price, and maybe in the first case that was the maximum price that has to be followed in the market. So with this we completed our second module, that is on theory of demand or demand analysis, and we'll start our third module, that is theory of production and cost, from the next session onwards. And these are the session references that is being followed, few books, few study material that is being followed for preparing this specific session.